Professor Liu, dal suo punto di vista di ricercatore, cosa sta succedendo e quali sono gli elementi più interessanti da rilevare in termini di innovazione e ricerca nel settore del cibo e della nutrizione?
Well, there are two areas I think are ripe for exploitation in converting science into public good. The one which I would consider bottom up, and the other which is more top down, and this is not in terms of who controls what. When I say bottom up, I mean from the ground and the roots to the crops, and then the top down is the processing and the consumption. Okay. The bottom up, there's no question in my mind that with arable land shrinking, population rising, water shortages being a significant problem, that we will need to have modified plants, modified food crops. So the concept of genetically modified organisms will not only be here to stay, it's going to be essential for our survival. Now, there are different ways to modify the genes. One does not have to put in foreign genes. There are marker-assisted breeding. There are approaches that speed up natural evolution, but in orders of magnitude. And I know that there are a number of companies doing that that would not violate the sense of the sanctity of the DNA. But nevertheless, we are modifying genomes. We have been modifying genomes since the beginning of agriculture. And I think we will have to continue to do this in order to make humanity survive. The second part, which I call top down, has to do with two things. Number one, food processing, processing and distribution. And then finally, a dramatically increased understanding of our diversity as a species in handling foods. Okay. Now, virtually everything we eat these days is, on the whole, processed. Even what we think is not processed comes from some processed source. The big surprise to many people is how much corn has in the United States at least, has been infiltrated, and not in the bad sense, but infiltrated into our food chain, so that as a inhabitant of North America, if you add up all aspects of my food, corn, even though I don't eat corn on a routine basis, actually accounts for a lot simply because it's been rendered and processed. Now, that's not altogether bad, but I do think that at some point we're going to need to monitor, for example, the sugar content in our cereals that we give our children. Should it be legislated or should it not? Because in many ways, like cigarettes, sugar is a natural product that we gravitate towards as a species. Nicotine, we gravitate towards. But yet we regulate cigarettes by taxation and by other means. Alcohol is a natural product, but we regulate it heavily by taxation, by limitations. At some point, we're going to recognize that the obesity epidemic that is taking place is partially the product of the availability of processed foods. The reason why processed foods may be the problem is not because it's inherently bad, but because to try to eat the same amount of calories in non-processed food, one has to spend a lot of time preparing and a lot of time eating. And of course, as you well know, we frequently don't have even that time to consume a regular meal, except perhaps in Italy, where they're much more civilized around here. So we do have this bottom-up and top-down development, which I believe science, and particularly genetics and genomics, is going to be very, very important.
E secondo lei quanto è importante l'educazione del consumatore in termini di spinta verso l'adozione di abitudini alimentari più sane, più equilibrate?
Absolutely, I totally agree with you. Having worked in health behavior research in the past, I can tell you that education in the classical manner of information transfer does not change health habits. We know that now. We know that if you just put in advertisements that say smoking is bad for your health, stop smoking, it does not change smoking habits at all. Okay. Now, does that mean we should give up on the so-called education? I don't think so, but I don't think we should view it in the same manner that we have for the last 300 years, which is education means you go to school, you get a textbook, and you learn. In fact, the people who've really been the most effective in what we would call education is really Madison Avenue. The individuals who actually understand how to pass a message on in perhaps the more humane, a more human aspect. Now, some people say that they're manipulative and what have you, but you'll be surprised how your interaction with me as a human being, about maybe 30% is actually the information being transferred. The other 70% is how you sit. Do I like the way you look? Did you comb your hair the right way? Those soft communication points become perhaps more important. Now, why do I say that? Because if you told a mother that eating sugar is bad for you, they'll say, I don't give my children sugar, I give them cereal. But you look in the cereal box, and guess what? It's a tremendous amount of sugar. Reminded me of a patient that I had when I was much younger and as a physician. An Asian lady in dialysis, and you know in dialysis you're not supposed to take a lot of salt. She was gaining weight and getting into heart failure, and our team asked her, you know, where are you taking the salt? And she said, I never take salt. And so we kept asking her and then find out that she was putting soy sauce, which again is salt. Now this is where the top-down processing really comes in. When you as a consumer have no choice, because if you go to the grocery store, that's all you get. No matter what your education is, you have to eat and you have to survive. So this is where I think rather than to segregate education as a separate point of attack, I do think we need to integrate that education part of it within the framework of what I would call the top-down alteration of our food chain.
I politici, i media, stanno dando secondo lei la giusta importanza ai problemi legati al cibo, food security, food safety?
I think it's considered in a proper way. I think the problem that we all have, it's not just Italy, it's all over the world, is how do you implement proper nutritional policies? It is much more difficult than one would imagine. Now, I don't think it's totally true that governments don't assist in nutritional export, let's just say. United States put a lot of resources in assisting the export of corn and soybeans. I dare say France puts a lot of emphasis on the export of the brand wines. Okay, all those are nutritional issues. United States and South America puts a lot of effort on meat production and so forth. So it is the economic drivers may be different from the health drivers. And the problem with the health drivers is there's no threshold. How much meat should you eat to be healthy? There are people who eat no meat, and there are people who say you shouldn't eat any meat, but I would venture to guess that you may not be a vegetarian. So unless there is actually clear thresholds that are defined, it's very difficult to have a cogent government policy other than to say, eat a square meal. And what does that mean? One last point I think is very important is that we underestimate the importance of food for our socialization, but also our sense of well-being. One of the biggest rise in meat consumption is because of China being prosperous. Their meat consumption has quintupled because meat in every society, except a few, is a special meal. It is associated with celebration. So when you have money, you buy meat. And that meat consumption actually has a great impact on the entire use of land and on agricultural consumption as well. So it's a very complex systems that we are here. Not impenetrable, but unlike the economists talking about how you measure economies and you manipulate things around, you can have central banks up raising and lowering the interest rates almost in unison at times, okay? We don't have a central food policy, nor do we have a central way of measuring what I would call a balanced food production. We have ways to measure food production, but where's the balance and where's the system?
La ringrazio, Professor Liu.
Good.